many have never heard me at all before. Reach to just those two people. I will suggest that we have so much literature, that we have a website, that we have tapes available. Traditionally, I have on these what we call rather prestigiously and perhaps overblown a personal appearance campaign, which is not really a campaign, but just a one-shot meeting. And I have talked about some issues involving the kingdom of God, that the young disciples who joined with Jesus Christ were young revolutionaries, and the last thing in the world they expected was the reform of the synagogue or for a holy Joe to come and tell them how to clasp their hands, say their beads, wear a cross, build a steeple, listen to organ music, have all kinds of rituals and rites. They didn't expect that Jesus Christ was coming to be a kind of a sky pilot, holy Joe, who would posture all the time and have sticky, smarmy religiosity surrounding him the way most people have been brought up to believe. They just do not understand the climate in which those young men lived. They do not understand what their hopes and dreams really consisted of. I might touch on that a little bit, but I want to tell you that just before coming here, my heart was absolutely swelling within me. It took my breath on a number of occasions. A lot of you were in your automobiles and were driving and couldn't see the commissioning of the USS Ronald Reagan, CVN 76. The Vice President was there. Senator Warner was there. Mrs. Reagan was there. Many of them, there were a couple of dozen admirals and a lot of Navy captains, and I don't think there's any uniform in the military that has ever been contrived that is any more breathtaking than a United States Navy admiral in white. And there they were, standing below this huge, big ship, more than 1,000 feet long, 19 stories to the top of the island, that will carry over 5,000, nearly 6,000 men and women and Marines into battle if and when it's required. And you look at the marvelous technology of the United States. You hear the speeches, you remember what Ronald Reagan stood for. Peace through strength. You remember what the nation was like when Jimmy Carter, with that failed faux pas trying to rescue our hostages from Iran and the mid-air collision of the helicopter and the aircraft in the desert. You remember 21% interest rates. You remember how the United States was held in absolute abhorrence and dismay. Well, it still is for different reasons, but at that time when President Jimmy Carter, with his ideas about Baptist sentimentality and so sort of concept of human rights that he was going to insist that other nations adopt all around the world based upon a kind of a theological concept of his own, and how different it was after a few years under Ronald Reagan. He gave this nation, for the first time in many decades, pride once again. He built up our military. Those great ships that were over there, both for Afghanistan and Iraq, wouldn't have even existed if it had not been for Ronald Reagan. Because the Lincoln, the Stennis, the Truman, these great huge nuclear aircraft carriers that can be at sea for up to 19 years without ever refueling. They can go hundreds and hundreds of thousands of miles around the globe so many times without refueling, like a floating city. Well, because I was privileged as a young man to be in the United States Navy, and because I'm a veteran of America's foreign wars, having spent a little bit of time offshore Korea on an aircraft carrier in 1951-52, and I remember so very much what life was like aboard an aircraft carrier launching our aircraft in strikes against North Korea, I couldn't help but be very deeply impressed about those ceremonies today. The next time you see a picture of the Ronald Reagan, I think you ought to realize the incredible might, the power, the energy, the inventiveness, the ingenuity, the technology of the United States of America. Walking into this Cobb Center, looking at the lobby, looking at this environment, Atlanta, one of the huge cities of the United States, looking at our infrastructure, looking at our wealth, looking at our power, you and I know that we live in the greatest nation, the most powerful nation that has ever existed on the face of the earth in history. But I could have said the same thing if I'd have been appearing before the Roman Senate in about 200 AD. I could have said, look at these marvelous monuments. Look at the size of our fleet. Look at the size of our conscripts and our legions. We occupy the Lemes far up in Britannia. We occupy all the British Isles and the Lemes up in Germany. We rule the world. We have built aqueducts to bring fresh water to cities all the way from Spain and Carthage and North Africa up and down the length and breadth of all of Europe, the Balkans, and indeed, in fact, in the Middle East. Rome was the mightiest nation to that time, but it was left to a man named Seneca to talk to the Romans, to tell them about some of the dry rot that was creeping inside their society that was eventually going to bring it down. Now, Rome existed for a lot longer than the United States has existed by many, many times over. So did Tyre, a great city-state. You could not have convinced people who were being entertained. First, it started out with just gladiators attacking one another with body armor, swords, and maces, and tridents. But that wasn't enough, so eventually became huge beasts and all kinds of extravaganza for the mob or the crowd to entertain the people. Taxes were out of sight. Urban crowding was incredible. Pollution, air, water, and solid was incredible in Rome itself. Divorce became commonplace. Gay rights wasn't a matter of rights, it was just there. I've told our people time and again that Sodom and Gomorrah did not suddenly just mushroom-like come out of the soil and become Sodom and Gomorrah. They were decent cities to start out, and there were just a few people who had an agenda. And over a period of decades, they had their way over the unprotesting majority, which eventually became the silent minority, which had no power to withstand what was happening in this perverse society. And God destroyed that pair of cities supernaturally, which has resulted in an eternal monument, most of whom the Protestants, the Catholics, I think, just sort of set that aside, or they couldn't be doing what they're doing because they are allowing such movements as you see in churches to have gay churches and ordaining gay priests and pastors. And you know that just the other day, the Supreme Court of the United States was in defiance of the highest court of heaven above, the Supreme Court of Heaven, in setting aside a law in my now adopted state of Texas that made the act of sodomy, which has got to be one of the most obscene, perverse acts of all, legal between, quote, consenting adults. And so here were these cities that became rotten to the core, and God intervened by destroying them with divine fire. But Rome fell from within. Rome fell because of internal rot. Rome fell because of its own success. Now, on the one hand, I find myself in conflict because I'm a very patriotic American. I grew up in Oregon. I was able to spend a lot of my summers on my uncle and my grandmother's farm up in near Oregon City, a little 45-acre Oregon farm with all the wonderful things to eat in the fields, and I so well remember those days when I was just a young lad. I grew up as a teenager during World War II. I missed that war by about 2 years. I joined the Navy shortly after World War II, only 3 years after the war in 1948. Had I been able to, my patriotism would have been such that I would have joined the Navy during the war. That was not to be my lot. But when the Communist Chinese attacked North Korea, attacked South Korea in 1950, I was sent aboard a United States aircraft carrier up at Alameda, or rather at Hunter's Point in San Francisco. I will never forget that Navy bus that took me driving along the edge of this huge gray ship, and it seemed to go on for a couple of city blocks, and then getting off and walking up the gangway and saluting the after brow and the flag, and then reporting aboard to the OD and taking my huge big sack that I was carrying on my shoulder and being shown where I was to have my quarters. I was among the first 120 aboard that ship while it was still crawling with civilians being demothballed to go to war. So oftentimes I find my knowledge of the Word of God, my dedication to Almighty God and to Jesus Christ, my absolute dedication and loyalty to the future world-ruling kingdom of God, not in conflict, but intermingled with my feelings of love of country, love of the United States of America, of her greatness and how great she should be, as well as how great she could be. And oftentimes I have preached before crowds numbering up to 15,000 people about what God's Word says about our country. I remember Ezekiel, and I want to quote a couple of things to you about Ezekiel, because in the 9th chapter of Ezekiel, he characterizes himself, as you know, as a watchman. And here was a prophecy from God that said Ezekiel was to portray to the people that there would be a watchman who would tell the populaces what was wrong with the society, and there was also a certain group of people who were to respond to that message. And they're called by a certain kind of a title here that I want you to understand. This great archangel cried in his voice and said, "Cause them that have charge over the city to draw near, even every man with his destructive weapon in his hand." That's Ezekiel 9, verse 1. "And behold, six men came from the way of the higher gate, which led toward the north, every man with a slaughter weapon in his hand. And one man among them was clothed with fine linen, and with a writer's inkhorn by his side." Linen was a type of a priest, and a writer's inkhorn obviously meant that he was like a writer or a correspondent. "And they went in and stood beside the brazen altar." That's a symbol of the throne of God. "And the glory of the God of Israel was gone up from the cherub." And if you read the first chapter, you see that the throne, the one we know of as became Jesus Christ, was carried about by these cherubim. "And whereupon he was to the threshold of the house, and he called to the man clothed with linen that had a writer's inkhorn by his side. The Eternal said to him, 'Go through the midst of the city.'" You remember that Jerusalem was typical of the entirety of all of the tribes of Israel, and in fact all of the known world at that time when Jesus Christ cried over it. He wasn't crying over just that city. He was crying over all the diaspora, all the people of Israel, all of the 13 tribes of Israel when you count them correctly, and in fact all of mankind. He wept over Jerusalem. He said, "How often would I have gathered you like a mother hen, her chicks under her wings, but you wouldn't have it that way." You remember reading years ago, or perhaps you remember from your childhood, how when he was under the burden of the stake, not a cross, but a stake, an upright pail, the trunk of a huge tree, and he was dragging it along what they now call the Via Dolorosa, or the painful way in Jerusalem. He would fall oftentimes, leading blood on the street. And women right beside him began to weep. Other strong men would put that huge big pail, that big tree trunk, back on his shoulder, and he would stagger a few more steps and fall again. And eventually they got someone else to carry it, if you remember, and had to carry it the rest of the way. He turned to those weeping women, and he said, "Don't weep for me, daughters of Jerusalem. If they do this in the dry, what shall they do in the wet?" Now he's talking about if they do this in a time of peace, what are they going to do when society comes apart? "Weep for yourselves and weep for your children because of what is coming on you in the future." Now here we are with Jerusalem as a type or a symbol of God's people wherever they are. I don't care if people do not believe, and I think most of you probably have long since proved to yourself the identity of the United States and the British Commonwealth, of Denmark, Norway, Holland, Sweden, of the nations of northwestern Europe, in the light of biblical prophecy, in the light of biblical history. And you know that we, even though we're a melting pot today, in the original colonies, in original immigrants who were like in a holding pattern, we have a man like Dwight Eisenhower with a German name, but he was not a German. You got thousands of people with Germanic names or with Dutch names or French names or British names who were part of Manasseh, who had emigrated or migrated to those points, who eventually came to the United States and founded this great country so many years ago. And I think if you haven't proved that to yourself, those of you that have access to our website, and you can tap it in by Garner Ted Armstrong, lowercase, no spaces, garnertedarmstrong.ws, garnertedarmstrong.com, I get it that way all the time. You can read that whole book there. Or if you haven't read Europe and America in Prophecy, and if we don't happen to have copies here, leave your name and address on a card or a slip of paper with someone out there, and we'll get it to you immediately. But it doesn't matter whether you believe that or not, because let me make a point. You know and I know that one of the reasons the United States is hated by much of the world today is because we are like a benefactor and a mentor of Israel. The entirety of all of Islam, 1.8 billion people, of dozens of nations in this world, all through the Middle East, all through Africa, all the way to Indonesia, all the way to the Balkans, hate us with a purple passion because of our assistance, our giant aid package, which actually is larger than many other nations put together, that goes every year to sustain the little nation of Israel. The fact that we came to their aid during the Nixon administration when we transshipped weapons from our forward NATO bases, like in Bad Tölz down near Bavaria, and rescued the Israelis who were very much beleaguered and about to go under by the two-pronged attack from both Syria and Egypt, at that time. So my point is this. It doesn't matter whether you think we are Manasseh and Britain is Ephraim or not when it comes to a war in the Middle East. You know that an attack by many Arab nations or any other nation against Israel would draw the United States into some degree of involvement. They're trying to get us involved right now. They want us to send more troops. Mr. Bush has been in Africa. They've been talking about possibly sending troops to the nation that we established under the Monroe administration so many years ago, Liberia, Monrovia, its capital named after the president, who came up with the idea of allowing slaves, former slaves in the United States, to return to West Africa and establish a nation where they could have a free government of their own. It proved to be somewhat of a limited success. A lot of you might not know that in history, but here George Bush has been promising billions of American taxpayer dollars to nations over there that have 37% of the population afflicted with AIDS. And AIDS is the direct result of bestiality. It's the direct result of the warning of God in the first chapter of the book of Romans, and I dared to quote that on WGN many years ago and was off of that station for over 2 years as a result. That's a particular kind of censorship. And so that I couldn't even talk about they receiving in themselves that thing that was going to result in their diseases from their evil practices. And to me, AIDS is as much a man-made disease as anything that has ever come along. It wasn't hiding under a rock and jumped out on somebody sometime. It's a result of the filthy practices of bestiality. I won't detail that or go into that for young, tender ears. Hideous. So my point is, you don't need to understand a doctrine about the United States being Manasseh to understand what history and what the future is going to portend for the United States of America. We face a world filled with enemies. Not just terrorists, not just Sunnis and Shias, not just Muslims, but lots of enemies, and they are in Europe, they are within us, they are all over the world, and they hate this country, they hate this government, they hate everything we stand for. They are jealous of our success. They are jealous of our affluence. They want what we have got. There are troublous times ahead for the United States. There's no question about that. Now, as characterized by Ezekiel, the man with the writer's inkhorn was given a task. And he was to go through the city and warn them of an impending, horrible destruction that was coming. And as he did so, he was told this. The Eternal said, go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, verse 4, and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. You see, when I think of America, and I sing the national anthem, or I sing God Bless America from Sea to Shining Sea, or I sing this new Lee Greenwood song, and I think of the words. We oftentimes will sing a patriotic song even to open our church services. Yes, I can think of the grain fields of Kansas and the orchards of Washington and Oregon. And I can think of the sea crashing on the rocks by Yahats on the Oregon coast. And I can think of all of the beauty and the verdant, wonderful fields and all of the fabulous wealth of Georgia, Alabama, Florida, with all of its citrus groves. I can think of all of the wonders that I've seen in Maine and Massachusetts. I've been to every one of our states, including Alaska and Hawaii, many a time. I've been all over the world. And when I would come back from the Middle East, or if I would come back from Central to South America, and I would say, look, we have curbs on our streets. We have sidewalks next to the curbs. Oftentimes, we have a park-like grassy area growing between the curb and the sidewalk. We have homes with indoor flushing toilets. Each home is like a miniature supermarket because in it, it will have at least one, maybe two freezers, maybe a big cabinet freezer in another room or the garage, and then the little freezer above the refrigerator. There will be up to 90 energy slaves in that home, all kinds of electrical appliances, even to open cans, or to compact trash, or to wash dishes. And you go to those other cities and you look at the poverty, the squalor, the disease, the sickness. You witness little children defecating as they talk to each other in the middle of a street. You witness little children making dams out of mud and actually floating their little fake boats in urine, as I saw in Cairo, Egypt. And you see the plight of the world. It's like you were in an airliner. The airliner has 100 seats. 96 of the seats are occupied by Americans. And they are, I should say, 96 of the seats are occupied, by third world people, these other citizens, and only four of the seats are occupied by Americans who are up in the front of the first class, and there is a kind of a curtain that separates them. In the back, they don't have anything. They have no water, they have no food, they have no seat, they just got a strap to hang on to. And if they have to go to the toilet, they just go where they stand. And up in the front are these people with all these luxurious, wonderful things, first class, being served filet mignon on a silver plate with cutlery and a goblet with maybe an imported French wine. And you ask the question, how long do you think those people in the first class department are going to last with all these have-nots, all these other people wanting what they've got? Now, time and again, I would look at one chapter that I want to go to in a moment, in the first chapter of the book of Isaiah, that characterizes Uncle Sam as we are today. I, being a patriotic American, do not want to see happen to our country what is going to happen. I don't like what is happening. See, on the one hand, I see the USS Ronald Reagan being added to our fleet as the Constellation is retired. And I realize that between 80 and 100 of the Tomcat F-14s or the Super Hornet F-18s are going to be aboard that ship, and at some point in time, there are going to be losses. We had 11 men lost. I saw a huge crash where one of our old Panther jets missed the cable barrier and hit some of the parked aircraft in front. A lot of people died. A lot were maimed and injured. I remember that very well. There will be operational incidents. There have been, like, the battleship turret that blew up aboard the Iowa. There have been cases where aircraft carriers off the Gulf of Tonkin had a fire that killed over 150 men. There will be things like that going aboard this floating city going on with the operational catapults and all of these aircraft. It's a very dangerous environment. On the one hand, I see the might, I see the power, I see the muscle, I see the economy, I see the tremendous infrastructure and the technology of this mighty power called the United States of America. I look at the fact we were able to enforce our will upon the nation of Afghanistan and get rid of a repressive regime, and do it again on a nation called Iraq and get rid of another repressive regime, even though these terrorists are sneaking up behind some of our men and putting a bullet in the back of his head when he's in a marketplace and unprotected. So on the one hand, I can be proud of our might, of our ability to project that power and that might anywhere in the world aboard these big floating airfields with a battle group of two Aegis-class cruisers with them, with the latest type of missile technology, of our huge big submarines that are bigger than the aircraft carriers of World War II, that carry aboard them not just the Poseidon Polaris, but the latest edition of MIRVs, many of these huge intercontinental ballistic missiles with multiple independently targetable warheads carrying more than 20 kilotons of explosive force and nuclear weapons apiece. One submarine, or for that matter, one B-52 bomber, carries aboard more destructive force than has been unleashed by every nation in every war in history up to this time. It's an awesome world in which we live. It's a dangerous world. So here I am, a citizen of the United States, watching today some of the most important people in the United States, Mrs. Nancy Reagan, and our Vice President, Dick Cheney, and admirals by the score, who were commissioning one of the mightiest battleships, one of the mightiest ships of war, the largest, the most technologically advanced to ever put to sea. What do you think men like Anson, Frobisher, Drake, what do you think men like Henry Hudson or Ponce de Leon would have thought of the USS Ronald Reagan if they'd seen her steaming by in a little cockle shell ship of wood not much longer than this room? We have progressed since the day that my father was a boy, and he was born before the Wright brothers ever flew at Kitty Hawk. And we have progressed from a time when I was a boy where milk cost 5 cents and an ice box was an ice box with a big chunk of ice and a little brown thing that was on little feet, I remember. You open it up, it was insulated, and you went out and got the iceman's block of ice with the tongs and put it in there when he came by. You see, I remember way before there was any television. We never had a television set until the late 1940s when I was a boy. And I remember plowing behind horses and raking hay, shocking hay. I remember cultivating and planting corn with an old corn planter with two handles on it. I remember times when we would read by a coal oil lantern in a house with no electricity and no running water up in Oregon. That's my lifetime. And my lifetime has gone by just like that. And now I've got 5 grandchildren. Look around twice, and from a little baby, they're up driving their own car. And it takes my breath. They say hindsight is 20/20. Hindsight is sometimes blinding sight, too, because years go whipping by with a rapidity that I don't know how to stop. Sometimes I'm tempted to go out in the front yard and grab the grass and say, wait a minute, slow this thing down, because it's just going too fast here. And I'm telling you that we live in these serious times, and there are very few people that know that. There are people that are so self-indulgent, they want every kind of sensual pleasure, and they want it now. So we've got these mincing, rotten gays who want to lead each other down the altar, who think that an exit is an entry, who don't know that the way God designed the human body is so that all the filth and the disease and the excrement is to go out an orifice which was never meant to be penetrated, to speak bluntly, by a human being who was designed of Almighty God with equipment to reproduce children. And we've got a bunch of old men in long skirts that don't know the difference between good and bad or clean and dirty. And they passed the law the other day in defiance of Almighty God, and the gays have been rushing up to Canada now that are allowing weddings, and the other day on the radio I heard that a girl wanted to marry a dog. Yeah, it's true, heard it. And I've said for years the day is going to come when a man's going to try to lead a horse down the aisle. And there are going to be people who will actually go along with that legally. You think I like seeing that kind of thing happening to the United States of America? You think I like thinking about a grandson of mine in a school that might be subject to the advances of some rotten queer, some closet queen, some filthy, obscene deviant who would try to get his hands on my grandson? I don't care what they call themselves. And they're not gay. They are wretchedly miserable is what they are deep down inside. They are not happy and gay. But they are everywhere around. And they have an agenda. And that agenda is to destroy the American family. That agenda is to have a public orgy. They don't want it behind closed doors anymore. They want it out in the public square. I've said for years, America wants an orgy, and God is going to give them one, but it's going to be a different kind of an orgy. It's going to be a blood orgy. It's going to be the kind of an orgy that hit Sodom and Gomorrah. If I turn to the first chapter of Isaiah and share this with you for a minute, he says, "Hear, O heavens, verse 2, and give ear, O earth, for the Eternal has spoken. I have nourished and brought up children, and they have rebelled against me." Now, I'll paraphrase this. We go along. A dumb ox knows his owner, and the ass his master's crib. But Israel does not know, my people doth not consider. Ah, sinful nation, a people laden, that's burdened down with iniquity, that's lawlessness, a seed of evildoers, children that are forsakers. They have forsaken the Eternal. They have provoked the Holy One of Israel unto anger. and they're gone away backward. Would you say the United States of America is a sinful nation? Why don't you take a look at the, don't do it. I was going to say, take a look at some of the websites available on the internet. Prurient pornography, filth, garbage. I mean, filth beyond your belief. You may as well talk about Mrs. McGillicuddy, who is sitting there watching some program and somebody comes running into her living room, pounding on the door and saying, here, take this. What is it? I found it's floating by in the sewer outside and thought you might want it. Maybe there's something there redeemable. I don't like the idea that we have a San Francisco with a Haight-Ashbury. I don't like some of our big cities. I don't like the fact that mass murderers and child molesters and serial killers exist in the labyrinths of our big cities. I don't like Chicago and St. Louis and Detroit, and I don't like a lot about Atlanta either. Some of the suburbs, beautiful. Infrastructure, great. Buildings, wonderful. But the people, some of the people, make it virtually uninhabitable. You've got to be afraid of people today. You pull up to a 7-Eleven, especially you women, you better stop outside for a while, especially at night. You thought, well, we're going to need milk, bread, eggs, and butter for breakfast. Well, got to make a quick stop. 7-Eleven, whatever they call it down here. One of those little quickie markets. Better use your head. Look long and steady inside and try to find out what's going on. Does the clerk look like he's standing there talking to somebody, or is he going about his business? Because you can walk into a robbery in progress. Our automobiles have been designed now, and even the rental car that we have, the minute I get in, if I click the little automatic button that will open the door, it'll just open the driver's door. It will not open the one on the sides or the sliding doors on a minivan. The minute I get in, put the key in, it locks it. Why do you suppose they did that? Why do you suppose you got the big gob of keys in your pocket, and the little peephole in your door? Because of crime. Because law-abiding citizens are oftentimes locked up at night indoors in what is like a little fortress while the criminals roam free. And we've got what's called recidivism or revolving door justice, where people go in for a heinous crime with a little slap on the wrist and are right back out in the street again because of the way the laws are written. We, as a nation, so many people do not agree with the death penalty. I could not agree with the death penalty more. But I think Susan Smith should have been put in an automobile, locked the doors, put her on a ramp, and slowly push her in a lake. That's what I think should have happened to that woman that did that to those little boys. I got a whole different idea about taking care of crime. And it's not just my ideas. Because, you see, that kind of justice is going to be imposed upon this world by Jesus Christ of Nazareth, who is coming as a returning, conquering warrior and not as some namby-pamby, sticky, sentimental little guy who would go over hill and dale just to reach every little widow lady to sit there and hold her hand, comfort her, and quote a little poetry and sing to her for a while. The attitude that some people have about Jesus Christ and the way to portray him is abominable. It's absolutely not true to the Word of God at all. He says, sinful nation, and we are. Why should you be stricken anymore? You will revolt more and more. The whole head is sick and the whole heart faint. Now let's just take old Uncle Sam here and we'll lie him out on a gurney and we'll take a look at him. The doctors are standing around, the nurse, he's got the stethoscope. The head, he says, is sick. Well, the head represents the government. How many people that were in government recently are in jail right now? I really have lost track. Think about the Clinton administration for a minute. And think about all the deals with the Riyadi bunch and the Chinese and the fact that they've got super sophisticated guidance systems in their nose cones of their ICBMs that were given to them by an administration only a few years ago. I think about illegal immigrants being given the right to vote. I think about people released from prisons given the right to vote. I think about people who were overseas serving our country in times of war whose absentee ballots were not counted. I think about anything and everything that some individuals have been able to do to propel themselves for a few more years in the White House and have access to Air Force One and all the perks and all the wonderful benefits of high power and high political office. I remember David Lawrence, who was the editor of the U.S. News and World Report many, many years ago during the LBJ administration, talking about the Gulf of Tonkin incident, talking about the mining of Haiphong Harbor, talking about the Vietnam War, that protracted scar that weaken and hurt the United States psychologically and spiritually so deeply. And he wrote the following, that LBJ, when he was running, dared not face the voters with another war on his hands. Something clicked in my mind. What? You mean whether we have a war or whether we don't have a war depends upon the whims or the needs or the desires of a potential political candidate. If it would be good for us, meaning good for him, to have a war, well, let's have a war. But if he doesn't dare face the voters with another war because he'd be voted out of office, well, then we won't have the war. It really educated me. That was 60s, I believe, late 60s, when I saw that editorial. And it just laid bare some of the personal agendas and motives of politicians who will go to any lengths, who will do virtually anything to get their hands on that power and that office. They will lie, they will cheat, they will steal. Some of them will resort to all kinds of nefarious, possibly even, some people have alleged, I do not know, murder. Now, did murder ever obtain, did murder ever prevail, did murder ever occur at the highest echelons of government anywhere that you know about? What about the two twins in a tower? What about Bloody Mary, the original one? What about Henry VIII and his wives? What about the times in British royalty? What about the Romanovs? And what about history of so many nations in Europe, the Balkans and Russia, where poisonings, knivings, garrottings, assassinations were commonplace? What about men who were murdered, like Herod the Great murdered his own son because he thought he was going to oust him from the throne? Do you think chicanery at that level ever occurs at the highest hallowed halls of government? Why, sure it does. It says here, the whole head is sick. And it is sick. There are men in the Senate, men and women who want office so bad they will do or say anything to get it. One woman I'm thinking about in particular. And I would just say it would be the greatest disaster in the history of this country if she ever gains office. And what appalls me, what almost scares me, except that I know God is going to prevail. If God allows it, he's allowed it because it'll be the last gasp of anything we can call the United States of America. You can kiss it goodbye and move to Australia. But I know that the agenda is there, that it's serious, and what shocks me is there are enough people out there who would vote for her that they would override roughshod over the conservative people in this country who believe in God Almighty, His Word, and rational common sense law. They don't care. They want a social system. They want cradle of the grave government benefits to take care of them. They want all of these entitlements. They want people to give them money. They don't want a job. They want a position. Americans aren't willing to work anymore. Why do you think the East Asians and the people from all over, like Bangladesh and India, and own almost all the little mom-and-pop quick food stores and gas stations in the United States? Why do you think they own all the old decrepit motels? Because they will live in one unit and work and work and work. And why do you think that all the groundskeepers, wherever I look around East Texas, are Chicano? There is not a Caucasian American among them. Americans will not stoop to work anymore. Nobody wants to work. Hey, let me tell you, we just finished a building about a little over a year ago. And I had known that way back before when we were building three Ambassador College campuses, and I'd been intimately involved with constructing buildings up into the millions of dollars. And I knew then what I learned again, up close, firsthand, that so many of these subcontractors and the workers themselves would like to do as little as possible for as much as possible. They would like to gouge you, they like to steal from you, they like to pad the time clock, they like to tell you they'll be on time when they're not, show up a month later. I mean, you deal with subcontractors, it'd just drive you to an early grave. It's unbelievable. And it shows you the kind of honesty there is among the working class in the United States, and the white-collar workers, and the blue-collar, and for that matter, kids in school, and the Naval Academy where cheating was found. There isn't anyone who is really exempt. So if I look at the head of this body lying on the gurney and it's old Uncle Sam, and I look and ask Is he healthy? How long has the old boy got to survive? It says, and the whole heart is faint. What's the heart? Well, let's say that that is the circulatory system. And what is it that keeps the body alive but the heart? Now, if you look at Americans, with about 92 million of us with some registered form of chronic disease, and you look at the incidence of AIDS that is out of control and growing rapidly all over the world, you look at genital herpes, at gonorrhea and syphilis, and some of the exotic forms of the filthy degenerative diseases as a result of the practices of many people. Then you look at multiple sclerosis, muscular dystrophy, heart disease, emphysema from smoking, mostly. You look at all the diseases that are pretty much self-inflicted upon the United States. Then you just look at the populace in general. I like to people watch sometimes. It disgusts me, but I do it anyway. When we were waiting in the airport yesterday to come over here, why, we were sitting at one of these little restaurants where the people are going by right by the gates, and I was telling the fellow who shined my boots a little later, I said, I made up my mind that about 47% of the American populace is way overweight. And so I say to myself, now, if a person is caught in the middle of an intersection and the light turns red, are they going to have the strength and the ability to get to the curb before the traffic hits them? And the answer is about half of them. We are a nation grown soft. I don't need to quote to you. The government itself is now going to start outlawing certain foods. You know, they're going to attack hamburgers. Have you heard that? They say you will buckle your seatbelt and you will quit smoking because you will stay alive as long as we can possibly squeeze any more tax dollars out of you. And then we will put you in a nursing home and we will even tax your Social Security if you'll let us. We are an indolent country. We're a fat country. We're a soft country. Oh, our military's not. No, sirree, Bob. You see those young men, and I hate to say it, but they always say, and women, which galls me, frankly. I don't think a woman ought to be in the military. I don't think it's their place. I don't think they belong there. I don't think King David ever had a single woman in his army. And I don't think Jesus Christ is going to have any female angels in his. So that's just my prejudice. I am not a male chauvinist pig, no matter what you women are thinking. My mother was a woman. I loved her dearly. My wife is a woman, and I love her dearly. We've been together more than 50 years. And I have great deal of respect for a womankind. They go through a lot more than we men do. It's like, who was it? Oh, who's the black comedian that's so famous, and I can't think of his name right now? Bill Cosby. You know, my wife gave birth to three of our sons, and Bill Cosby said, the nearest thing I can tell you childbirth is like is grabbing your lower lip and pulling her over your head. And I guess that's about right. You know, women can stand pain a lot more than men. Well, enough of that. My wife knows that I'm not a male chauvinist pig. She just knows I'm male. That's the end of that. And from the sole of the foot, even under the head, there is no soundness in it, but wounds and, it says, bruises and putrefying sores. So this is God's analogy. This is a body that is sick, folks, from within and without, from head to toe. They have not been closed, neither bound up nor mollified with ointment. And who is responsible to heal the body? Why, the leadership, the people that show where are the afflictions, where are the wounds, and they are not doing that. You know, the pulpits in our country do not cry aloud and spare not and show my people their sins because they do not agree what sin is. They've done away with God's law, or so they think. I just the other day completed another book that I want to make sure all of you read. And it's entitled, Where Do You Find in the Bible, quote, Thou Shalt Keep Sunday, end quote. I wrote it as a result of a letter from a man in Missouri who wrote to me and he said, I have read your booklet, Why Would Anyone Want to Keep Saturday for Sunday? And I found that I was completely convinced. But he said, I decided to ask a man, and he named a certain television program, and ask his opinion. And he said, he sent me this paper I'm enclosing to you, and it sounds very rational and very logical. And now I'm back to square one where I started. I'm just not sure. And he said, maybe you can point out where some of these errors are. Oh, can I ever. He dragged out the same old shop-worn, tired, dog-eared, like Acts 20, verse 7, Revelation 1, verse 10, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. John was having a meeting, breaking bread with the disciples on the Lord's Day, when the Diagogue came to be in the Spirit into the day of the Lord, as anyone with a common sense to look it up knows. Anyway, I wrote a very lengthy booklet on that subject. I hope that every one of you will get it. Well, this man was trying to convince the man from Missouri that the law had been done away. He said Jesus nailed it to his cross. That's the same old language you heard in whatever Baptist, Methodist, Episcopalian church you were in as a child. That the law is done away. Did you ever analyze it? Why? What is bad about thou shalt have no other gods before me? Oh, I can't stand that one. What is so bad about thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything in the heavens above or the earth beneath or the waters under the earth? For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto the thousandth generation of them that love me and keep my commandments. Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. As Paul said, the first command with promise. What's the matter with that one? Now we come to the fourth. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. For in 6 days the Lord created the heaven and earth, the sea and all that in them is, and rested on the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. When he hallowed, he made it holy. He set it apart for holy use and purpose. And it says in Mark 2:26 and 27, that the Sabbath was made for man and not man for the Sabbath. Therefore, the Lord is Lord of the Sabbath day. And I went through all of that in this booklet. That's the one they don't like. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not covet. There isn't a Baptist in the pulpit anywhere that disagrees with any of those precepts. But they are in a Sunday observing world. And they've grown up in it. And they can't let go of it. And they will use any excuse they can find to try to get around it. They will lie. They will minimize and exaggerate. They will avoid, like the plague, certain scriptures in the Bible that would destroy the very precept that they're trying to get across. And I think some of them know better. I think consciences here and there are stinging. I know what Jesus Christ said to the Pharisees. And he said, you say, we see, therefore your sin remains. And I think that's true of some of them. Not all of them, but some of them know better. I remember strange confessions of some of those who fell aside in what became, I think, the greatest reversion to paganism and sun worship in the history of the world, when the former worldwide church of more than 150,000 members marched straight backwards into Protestantism under leaders who were sycophantic interlopers that came along and took the reins of power after my father died. And I remember one man telling another man, how do you deal with it? He was asked, oh, I just pull these blinders right down over my eyes. Said so, quote unquote. There were too many people who had already gotten up to be about age 54 or 5, some of them have died even recently, that had to be loyal to that signature on that paycheck, because the only thing they had known from a boy going to college at age 18 or 19, finding a wife and marrying her in Ambassador College and going out and laying the law down and beating over the head in a very Hitlerian, autocratic fashion, a lot of farmers and people who were in their 60s and 70s and a lot older and oftentimes a lot wiser than the young man in the pulpit. And the only thing some of those young graduates of Ambassador College knew was church government and authority and doctrine, and on and on and on they went. Well, now they were in their middle age. And along came this church that just absolutely imploded from within. They wouldn't have known anymore unless one of their own parishioners had given them a job. They wouldn't have known how to go earn a living. And so many of them sat right there, and their loyalty was to the paycheck, what that signature was on that paycheck, not to principle that they'd stood there and preached and taught at the top of their lungs for, in some cases, 20 and 30 years. Pretty sad. It shows when the chips are down where some people's loyalty really is. Now he said, your country is desolate, your cities are burned with fire. I did not agree at the first reaction of Jerry Falwell and some others, he later had to retract it, that the attack on 9/11 was punishment against America for her sins. I do agree that God exists and that God allowed that to happen and did not prevent it. End of story. God allowed it. Otherwise, it couldn't have happened. Now, whether or not God-fearing people ought to take that as a lesson as to what can happen. I mean, those were the two biggest buildings in the world, the two tallest buildings on the planet. The absolute skyline of New York. I've since seen some old rerun movies from 20 and 30 years ago that showed those buildings there and the whole skyline of that great huge city they've called Gotham and the Big Apple and New York has been very dramatically altered. Your cities are burned with fire. Is that a future prophecy for what is yet to happen to the United States? Your land, strangers devour it in your presence. Now, in one sense, because God says the stranger that is within thee shall get himself up very high and you shall be brought down very low in Leviticus 26. Part of that is obtaining already. But it may happen in far greater degree later on. And it is desolate, it is overthrown by strangers. And the daughter of Zion is left as a cottage in a vineyard, a lodge in a garden of cucumbers, as a besieged city. Except the Eternal of Hosts had left us a very small remnant, we should have been as Sodom. We should have been like unto Gomorrah, completely destroyed. Hear the word of the Eternal, you rulers of Sodom. Give ear unto the law of our God, you people of Gomorrah. I have written several commentaries with that very title, or at least using that in the body of it, that I published on our website recently because of what is happening in our country, in the very topmost court in this country, allowing that kind of thing to go on. I want to reiterate for you a few things because I think it is important for us to rehearse in our own mind why we are and what we are. Jesus Christ of Nazareth was prophesied to come into this earth as the Mashiach ben David, or the Messiah, son of David. Now, think about, and I've talked about this before, some of you have heard sermons along this line, so I'll just encapsulate it very quickly and not drag it out. Those of you that never heard this before, you can get tapes on it from some of my most recent meetings in other places if you would like. Think of the fact that the United States of America never knew what the Danes, the Dutch, the Norwegians, the Poles, the Czechs knew during World War II. You and I have never lived in an occupied country. We have never had a big billboard put out there, anyone found on the street after 6 p.m. will be shot. We have never had a group of underground who waylaid, like they're doing in Iraq today to us, a passing convoy and killed some Germans, and then they take, as they did in Lidice in Poland, the entire village, herd them into a barn and set fire to the barn. We haven't had that happen in the United States. We don't know what it's like for someone to bang in the door and billet his troops in your house. We don't know what it's like for people to come in and rape your wife in your own sight. We just don't know what it's like to be brutalized by an occupied country. But they did. Peter, James, John, Andrew, Bartholomew, Simon the Canaanite, James the Little or the Less, the son of Alphaeus. All of them knew what that was like. When Jesus said to them at that time, if a man take away your coat, give him your inner garment also, it was because a Roman soldier could do precisely that. He could come up and say, here, to this elderly man, I want that tweed coat you're wearing, and it's snow on the ground and it's cold outside. And the soldier could simply take it. Fine, here you are, take my shirt too. That's what Christ said. If a man compel you to go a mile, well, to carry a heavy Roman mail sack or something else, go with him too. It was couched in the time of people who were suffering from Roman occupation, from the brutal regime of the Herods, kind of like a Saddam Hussein of his time. Remember the pogrom of Herod the Great trying to kill Christ, who murdered thousands upon thousands of little boys from age 2 on down to 1 day old, taking little babies, squalling, out of the arms of their mother and dashing them against a stone, throw them in the air and catch them on a spear's point. They murdered them by the thousands in cities all up and down the modern nation of Israel. How would you like to live in that time? Now, the prophecies of the Bible did not predict a new religion. You can't find it. It isn't there. You can look from Genesis to 2 Chronicles, the way the Bible ought to end in the Old Testament, in this case perhaps the way yours is and mine in the King James, to the last chapter of Malachi, and you cannot find a single prophecy about the synagogue being revitalized or revised. You can't find a single prophecy about women's hair lengths or skirt lengths or men's habit of dress or hairstyles or the length of men's hair. You can't find a single thing about liturgy, about beads, about steeples, about organ music. You can't find a single thing having to do with processions and huge crosses and the Gregorian chant. You can't find a thing about, quote, religion in the way that you've had it portrayed to you all of your life. They were not expecting a religious person to show up among them and teach them a new religion. But what do you think the average Protestant thinks? They think that along came Jesus Christ, who was as soft as a feather pillow, who was almost effeminate in his appearance. He had long hair, went around with a shepherd's crook, a little lamb in one arm with a far-off look in his eye, trying to find a sick baby somewhere. He would go over hill and dale anywhere. Oh, there's a little widow lady. Just hold it, everybody. I got to go meet her. It's only a 20-mile walk. I'll be back in 3-4 days. That's what they think. They think he tried to save everyone he could. One great evangelist always would say, everyone that Jesus Christ called, he called publicly. That isn't true, but he liked to say it that way. Well, the Bible says, and I'm going to quote a few things like that, in Isaiah, the 9th chapter, for example. I'll turn to that and give you a little bit of that. Unto us a child is born, verse 6. Now, these prophecies were known and were taught to people who believed the scroll of Isaiah. They were taught in the synagogue. These kids had grown up. You've grown up as a kid being toddled off to Sunday school, learned the 23rd Psalm, right? And as a little kid, you had to memorize the Lord's Prayer. Now I lay me down to sleep, I pray the Lord my soul to keep. Oh, y'all memorized that too, didn't you? Kind of like the tooth fairy and finding a quarter or a tooth under your pillow. You learned all of that stuff when you were little. This is what they learned. Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. The government shall be upon his shoulder. And his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Now, what does peace mean to you? I'm sure you understand what peace means. You're Americans. It means freedom from war. But it means far more than social order, because the Germans had social order under Hitler. It means freedom as it is expressed in the Constitution of the United States. Freedom of doing what we're doing now. Freedom for me to do what I'm doing right now. Freedom of assembly. Freedom of speech. Freedom of worship, of religion. Freedom of the press. Freedom from being oppressed, expropriated, appropriated, deported, abused, incarcerated by any authority whatsoever. Freedom to go and find a place and try to do like a man that one day walked by without a job and saw that there was a lot of trash around an old ice plant and decided just to start picking it up. And he picked it up and he cleaned up. The owner finally came out, here, young man, what are you doing here? Well, I just thought that I'd make myself useful. Well, I'm sorry, I can't pay you. Well, that's all right. I just saw all this trash and everything. It looked kind of ugly from the street and I thought I'd help out. He was there the next day. And the next day, and began looking so nice, and he made so many changes that finally the owner said, well, yes, I can hire you. And so he hired him and gave him a job. As the days went by, he got to move inside. It was real cool and work on making the ice. And it became so good that eventually he began to deliver ice in one of the trucks. And eventually he earned so much money that he became the second in command. And by the time the old ice man died, the man who had walked on and just started to work because he saw work that needed to be done owned the ice plant. That's called entrepreneurship. That's called work. That's called the American way of hiring yourself a job and not always just asking someone to pay you for being there and having a position and making a lot of money that you really didn't earn. Freedom means a man seeing a plot of ground and being able to build on it and to plant on it and to marry and raise a family and to grow the food from that ground. Like our original settlers, our homesteaders and our pioneers did all over this United States when during the Monroe Doctrine of Manifest Destiny they spread out all over this country and we purchased under the Louisiana Purchase more than double the size of the nation at that time. And America grew great because of freedom. And all of those freedoms were exercised. Oh, there were abuses, sure. I know the Hollywood Westerns are just filled with a lot of that garbage, but much of it is fantasy and never really occurred, but some of it did. So government, peace, freedom, that's what they looked for. They were an occupied country, and that's what the Bible promised. Of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end. You read one word there about religion. Is there one word about organ music or the height of the steeple or men or women's dress? Upon the throne of David, I could take time to read for you the first chapter of Luke, the end of it, that talks about he shall inherit the throne of his father David, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. But I won't do that. I think you've heard that before and you know it. Upon his kingdom to order it, to establish it with judgment and justice from henceforth, even forever, the zeal of the eternal of hosts will perform this. That was a prophecy about the coming Messiah. It was the hope of a deliverer to break the yoke of Rome, to get rid of the Sanhedrin, and to break all of these political and even social and religious powers that took away the freedom and the human rights and dignity of the average person and gave them liberty and freedom. He called it liberty to the captives, captives both spiritual and mental. In the 11th chapter, it says in verse 4, but with righteousness shall he judge the poor, and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth, and shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. It then goes on to describe conditions that are to become extant during the kingdom of God on this earth. Now you all know that the gospel is a message that means the good news about the coming world-ruling government of God. You don't understand, probably, many of you, the extent to which those young men that gathered around Jesus Christ thought it was going to happen right then and there in their lifetime. It would have been incredibly cruel to tell them anything else. If you look at what happened, and I'm going to turn now to the book of Luke, for those of you that did bring a Bible, for those that didn't, don't worry about it. At the Last Supper, quite an altercation began. Now remember that they'd had all these experiences with Jesus Christ, the feeding of the 4,000 and 5,000, the healing or the resurrection to life of Lazarus at the tomb. They had now been able to look back at the triumphal march into Jerusalem, where they were waving the palm fronds and saying, Jerusalem, behold your king. Didn't say your right reverend or your vicar or your pope or your minister. It said, behold your king. And every one of those great events, when he cleansed the temple, for example, and overturned the money changers' tables, had doves flying around and cattle being herded out and all the offal on the floor, and said, take these things hence. It is written, my Father's house is a house of prayer, and you've made it a den of thieves. They had to think at that Passover season, this is it. Finally, this is the time. They had always thought it before at the Passover, a time of great pilgrimage, a time of thousands of people from all over the diaspora who would come in on a pilgrimage for a holy day at Jerusalem. They thought it during the Feast of Tabernacles, during perhaps Yom Kippur or Rosh Hashanah, the feast of the memorial of the blowing of trumpets. But always they were frustrated. It never occurred then. Now he said to them something interesting. It said, verse 23 of Luke, the 22nd chapter, they began to inquire among themselves which of them it was that should do this thing, when he had said, one of you is going to betray me. And there was also a strife among them. Now, if you have family strife, what do you got? Emotion, hurt feelings, temper. Do you think during family strife anybody ever raises their voice? Oh, this was an argument, folks. There was strife among them. No one doubled up his fist. If he did, all he did was shake it, but nobody hit anyone. But there was strife. This was at the table when Christ was very heavy in his heart and mind, knowing what lay ahead of him only hours away, and his disciples are arguing vociferously, oh no, it's not going to be. Well, yes, it is. You know, strife. Strife was among them, over which should be accounted the greatest. Now, we had that kind of strife at Ambassador College. It was called Musical Chairs or King of the Mountain, but it was all very, very quiet. It was all very political. You walk around, look, I didn't know that knife was in my back. Well, yeah, it's there, Ted, it's sticking out. You better go remove that anyway. But that was a different kind of strife. Now, this was overt. I mean, this is people just out there in each other's face. And he said unto them, the kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and they that exercise authority upon them are called benefactors. I said before, the government gives us a tax break and just lowers the tax amount a little bit, and we think that they're giving us money, when actually all they're doing is allowing us to keep more of what we made in the first place. But it's just the way they do it. It's like, come on down to King Chevrolet and save. They say it in East Texas that they don't say save, they say save. S-I-V-E, save. Come on down and save. And there's one, I heard it on TV the other day, the more you buy, the more you save. Wow, what in the world? The more I spend, the more I save? I mean, but that's what they say if it's a reduced price. And a reduced price is a real price. And the price they say they reduced it from is a fake price that was never there in the first place. Anyway, you know that. You're all consumers. But you shall not be so, but he that is greatest among you, let him be as the younger, and he that is chief, he that does serve. For whether is greater, he that sits at meat or he that serves? Is it not he that sits at meat? Like the Lord Chamberlain or the owner of the house. But I am among you as he that serves. You are they which have continued with me in my temptations, and I appoint unto you a kingdom. There's not a Protestant minister in the world who can take that phrase and build a sermon around it. I can, very easily. Means exactly what it says. They thought it meant exactly what he meant to say, and he meant to say exactly what he said. Because they looked for a government overthrow. They looked for a change in rule. They looked for a regime change. They looked for Christ to establish himself on the throne, removing Herod and getting rid of the Romans and riding over the Sanhedrin and replacing it with a system of justice in which they wanted a part. How excited would you be if one of you had been, let's say the next time we elect another president, depending on who it's going to be, of course. Maybe we better go back to the last election. And let's say that one of you had been appointed as a member of the president's cabinet. Now think about that, because a whole bunch of them were. You know, there's a process, a big long list, and then a short list, a lot of advisors, and finally here's the caliber of person, here are the qualifications, and we want Mr. So-and-so, he served here, served there, here's his war record. He's been in politics, he's been in the Senate, he's been in the armed forces, whatever. We want him to be the Secretary of Defense. What do you suppose was beating in the breast and in the brain of the future Secretary of Defense as they mount the podium and they're going to see their new Commander-in-Chief sworn in? I am going to be a part of this new government. Every so often he's going to ask my advice. I'm going to sit at a great big polished walnut table in a wonderful room and be taken seriously about all of my ability and my past, my expertise, my experience. He's going to ask my advice. How wonderful, how excited, how fulfilled would someone feel if they'd been tabbed to be a cabinet level of a new government and think, I can get some things done. I can make some reforms. I can clean up the Treasury. I can clean up the Defense Department. I can make some meaningful changes here. That's what these young men thought was happening. That's what Christ plainly told them. He said, I appoint unto you a kingdom. They thought now. They thought in my lifetime. They didn't think I'm going to die and thousands of years later it's going to come to pass and I'll get resurrected. They didn't think that at all. Now, what I'm telling you has not ever been told any American audiences from the time I began to preach it. And yet it is as logical and plain as the nose on your face. And bless his heart, my father didn't know this either, not in this sense. He didn't sense it in that way and didn't present it in that way. He knew the gospel, he knew the truth, he knew God's word, he knew about the kingdom of God, but he didn't clue into the fact that these young revolutionaries expected it was all to be set up in their lifetime. He said, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Wow. Sit on a throne. I mean, that's a very exalted position, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And then, of course, they went on with this thing of betrayal. And he said, Peter, in verse 32, when you're converted, strengthen the brethren. Turn to Acts, the first chapter, And I've quoted this before in some of these messages, but to hurry along with this real quickly and try to bring it to a conclusion. This was the most burning question in their minds when, after 40 days of being unwilling witnesses and having had it proved to them beyond a shadow of a doubt that he had been dead, he was resurrected, he was alive, finally they came together. And when they were therefore came together again, verse 6, they ask of him, saying, "Lord, will you at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel?" They didn't say, "Will you at this time mount your throne to govern the whole world, Germania and Britannia and Hispania and so on." Talking about the greater Solomonic or Davidian kingdom that extended from modern-day Iraq down to the Nile River at the greatest limits of Israel at the time of Solomon. "Will you now restore that kingdom at last? Now you've got all power." He came to them and said, "All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go you therefore into all the nations, preach the good news." He said before, and they must have remembered because it said that they now called to mind after the Holy Spirit came, and here we're going to have that right in the next chapter in the book of Acts. All those prophecies that he had spoken, then it became clear to them. Before then, they didn't really get it the way they should have. "Will you at this time, finally, at last, after all of our frustrations?" How frustrated do you think Peter was when he tried to start the revolution by pulling out his sword and killing Malcolm? And he got rebuked because he sliced off Malcolm's ear and Christ healed it. And he said, "Put up your sword." And Peter, of course, forsook him and then cursed and took God's name in vain and swore three times and said, "I never knew the man." Peter was filled with wrath. He was bitterly disappointed. He was let down beyond belief. He was frustrated. He felt rejection. He thought, "I've been right next to him. How could he say that to me?" He was furious. Read the account. You know it's true. A man doesn't change like that from being the bombastic guy that you'll never, "I'll go with you, Lord, wherever you've got to go," and being just like his right-hand man, to saying in that same night after he's betrayed, "I never knew the man." Unless something raging going on inside of his heart and mind. So it shows you what Peter expected up until the time of Peter's own personal feelings of betrayal. Now here we are with them having seen him, handled him, eaten with him 40 days and 40 nights, knowing that he's alive, knowing that he has all power. "Will you at last, after all of our frustrations, will you at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel?" Said nothing about any other nation, because it wasn't in their mind that it would be any other nation. And he said, "It's not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own power. But you shall receive power after that the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me," unto his life, unto his gospel, his message, unto his works, his miracles, unto the future prophecies concerning his world ruling government, unto me in Jerusalem, that's here locally, and in all Judea, that's a Roman province, and in Samaria, and that was a shock to them because Samaria was inhabited by dark, swarthy people who had been replaced there by the Babylonians about 90 miles north of Jerusalem. "And unto the uttermost parts of the earth." Now they thought, "We got quite a job to do." When he had spoken these things, they saw him go up. Now when Jesus came, he commissioned the disciples. He gave a great commission to them. He said, "Go ye therefore into all the world and proclaim, preach, publish, announce, whatever you will, the good news of my coming kingdom. And I am with you always, even unto the end of the world." When they had a parting conversation with him, "What is going to happen to this man? What's going to happen to me? What's going to happen to him?" And he was asked that of both Peter and John. And he said, "Peter, the time is coming when they will lay hands on you and take you where you wouldst not. And as for him," the other disciple, "what is it to you if I say he should stay until I come?" It would have been horribly cruel to tell those men, "This isn't going to happen in your lifetime. It's going to happen 2,000 years hence." Now we come down to the fact, whether we know it, whether we believe it or not, and I think all of you do believe it, you and I are living in the exact moment in time when Peter and James and John and Bartholomew thought they were alive. Instead of a Messiah, you can see an evangelist, a minister, you cannot see the one who is going to come because he is seated at the right hand of God the Father in heavens above. And he is on a countdown. There is a timetable. There's a definite series of events that has to take place in the Middle East, here in our country, in Europe, in the Balkans, in Japan, in the Pacific, all over the world. And when all of those things come to fruition and come to a head, and this great country of ours, like Rome before us, is tottering on its last legs and is about to come crashing down. We are already bankrupt. That's neither here nor there. But when we are unable any further because of a series of disasters that none of us can foretell, some of these big aircraft carriers are eventually going to be sunk. And some and many, if not many, of our aircraft are going to be shot down. And eventually the United States, like Rome before us, will fall because your Bible predicts it. Now the ones who are going to be rescued from that and the ones who are going to share a position of rulership with Jesus Christ in his kingdom are the ones described in that ninth chapter of Ezekiel. They are those who sigh and cry for the abominations that they see all around them. They are patriotic Americans. They are patriotic British. They are patriotic Australians and New Zealanders. They're patriotic Danes and Dutch and French. They're patriotic people of the tribes of Israel all over the world. They don't owe their allegiance and their thanksgiving to the very same founding fathers or to the same principles. But in large measure, if you look at the sixth chapter of Revelation and you see all of the 12,000 of every one of the tribes save Dan, that are going to fall to their knees and repent before God when they see the heavenly signs unfolding before them. The great harvest of the work of God that has been going on for these last 50 years is not going to take place until the time of the heavenly signs. I have preached these messages, I've preached this word before thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions, and tens of millions for the bulk of my lifetime. I've preached in Australia and England. I preached in Jamaica and Canada. I have preached over tens of thousands of television programs, tens and tens of thousands of radio programs, thousands and thousands of sermons before live audiences. And how many converts are there? How many members are there? How many willing cohorts are there? How many people are willing to pick up the gauntlet, to put their hand to the plow, to get involved and to get busy and to do the work? Or how many are just entertained? I have people who have come to see me say, I just really enjoy hearing you speak. I had a man tell me one time backstage, Ted, that was just a wonderful message today. What a voice, what technique. That one long pause, whatever. You know, there they go. Ezekiel found the very same thing was said of him. They love to talk of you in the way and say, have you ever heard a man speak like that before? But they come as the people do, and they hear your words, but they will not do them. I have come and laid the following challenge before people many a time, only to have almost no one pick up the challenge. I have said, I am here on a recruiting mission. I am here representing the next great world-ruling government, and I'm here to offer you an opportunity to be in on the ground floor and to have a wonderful position in that government of authority and of rulership in the world the way it's going to be tomorrow. Preach my heart out. Go through all these precepts. Preach about Jesus Christ and about forgiveness and about the law, repentance and baptism, the receiving of God's Holy Spirit. When it's all over, someone will come up and try to hand me a piece of literature from his church. Invariably, there'll be some ding-a-ling come up and try to give me some kind of a theory we all came from Mars. Somebody else will come up, and then we'll find out afterward there have been about 330 people or 220 people or 115 people there. Well, how many new people are attending? Well, we think there might be one or two from down yonder. So, you know, one or two thought maybe they'd show up. Well, how many showed up last Sabbath? Well, nobody showed up last Sabbath, but we still hope one of them did call and say he might show up later. Now, I don't want to paint a picture of negativism here. and let you know that there's never any success, because that's not true. And the important thing is, it's like the parable of the sower. I plant a seed, and the earth upon which that seed falls is either rich and deep and full, or it's thin and shallow and stony. And whatever you do with what has been planted becomes your responsibility. I go my way, and my wife and son go back to Tyler, Texas, and we just leave the result with God. And then you have a responsibility as to what you do with what you've heard. Because knowledge carries with it responsibility. And when you know that this nation is in the kind of shape it is, and the world is in the kind of shape it is, and you know what the future generally might hold, the wars of the future, not only in the Middle East, but all over the world, maybe with North Korea, maybe with Iran, maybe even eventually, and it is going to happen eventually, between the United States and Europe, you can't be like the person that says, I think I'll just wait until it's right at the very doors, and then I'll get busy and repent. Doesn't work that way, because God won't allow you to use an excuse like that. He will say, ah, but you knew. And you knew in plenty of time. So yes, I'm here on a recruiting mission. And I'm hoping that when my son announced that there is a local church here, and there are people here from other groups all around, and I think that information is on the table out there in the front, that some of you will decide you would like to hear the sermon that I preach next week and the week after that, because I don't always go out and just talk to people who are brand new. We only had two brand new people here. What does that tell you folks? Well, now when I say brand new, I mean two people that have never heard me speak before in person. We've got brand new people here who have never attended one of our Feast of Tabernacles. How many of you are people who have not attended our own local church services before? Can I see your hands? How many have not? Don't be hesitant. I mean, don't be embarrassed. I'd like to see. Come on, more. I know there are more of you than that in here. Little kid, about 3 years of age. I'm just kidding, but very few. Now, what does that tell you staunch, long-time, sacrificing, hard-working members? Tells you the message isn't getting out like it should, doesn't it? Doesn't it tell you this is one of the best-kept secrets in Atlanta today? Go look at that great big hall when you go by out there. It's almost as big as a football field. That's where I ought to be, on a podium before 10,000 people with a message just like the one I just gave you. And we ought to have a major television channel here. But you know, it's kind of catch-22. We got to depend upon God, because it's like the guy that went to get a job and they said, you can't have a job until you join the union. I went to join the union. You can't join the union until you have a job. Well, we can't get on television until we have enough people to support us. But we don't have enough people to support us till we get on television. So we depend upon God little by little, here and there, to call people who will put their hand to the plow and will help us do what we've got to do. I know what I'm supposed to do with my life. Do you know what you're supposed to do with yours? That's basically what it boils down to. Those of you that have never attended our Festival of Tabernacles, I hope you will make every effort to get to either Myrtle Beach over in South Carolina, North Carolina? South Carolina. And or Panama City Beach in the panhandle of Florida, two of the lovely resort sites where we have the Feast of Tabernacles for 8 full days. We will have a newspaper I'm putting the finishing touches on, and when I get home, we'll have all of the festival elders will have sent their information back to us, I hope, and we'll try to get it out in the next very few weeks. It'll be a kind of a midsummer edition. It'll have a great big layout in the middle of it of all the feast maps and information. And I hope you'll be planning to come to the Feast of Tabernacles this fall. And I hope that all of you that are in local hosted fellowship groups will be very energetic. Don't hide your light. Don't be a bit shy about telling me that maybe I need to get over to where you folks are and have one of these meetings over there and stimulate a little bit of growth. We have other people that do that, like in Fayetteville and up in Norfolk. And out in Sacramento, where I may have to make another trip. We're scheduled to be in Des Moines, I think, in about 3 weeks, 2 weeks or 3 weeks, I forget. And then a couple of weeks after that, down in Chattanooga, Tennessee. We've been several places all over. I'm not to the point where I can do what I used to do and have 30 of these every year. I may look a little younger than I really am, but I'm no spring chicken anymore. And it is a little bit difficult. So we do as many as we're able. and as many as God provides support for. And we try to get out and meet the people in person as much as we possibly can. Let them know who we are, what we're about, what we're doing, why we are, what is the commission of the church. Christ said, I will build my group. I will call my assembly. I will call my people. Didn't say I'll build the church on the corner. The word church is ecclesia, or ecclesia, if you prefer, or ecclesia, some people pronounce it. It merely means an assembly of people. And he commissioned them to go out and to preach, proclaim, write, print, whatever, get into people's minds the good news of the coming kingdom of God. I've tried to show people the difference between the message of the coming world-ruling government of God, which is a government, and all this religiosity stuff. Parading around in robes and holding your hand like a steeple because you think your soul's going to escape your body and flit around like a naked baby in heaven all day. It doesn't make sense. There's no logicality, no rationality to the doctrines of the Catholic and Protestant church. The idea of the doctrine of the immortality of the soul is a lie. Going to heaven when you die is a lie. Burning forever and ever and ever, for pity's sake, how would you like your little finger under a Ronson cigarette lighter for 3 minutes? And they say because you made a mistake, told a lie, stole some marbles when you were six, you did something bad, or you just happened to be born in Vietnam, you're going to fry and burn and blister forever and ever and ever and ever. What kind of a God is it they portray to people? Is that a God who says, I am love, a God of mercy, a God of forgiveness? The doctrines of this world are absolutely satanic. They are rotten, they're wrong, they're false, and the truth of God is beautiful, it is precious, it is logical, it is obvious, it is comforting, it is encouraging, it's inspiring. And if you want to have a part in the future world-ruling government, you better begin to have a part as soon as you can right now. Thanks for coming, everyone. If you would, I will conclude like I try to do sometimes by asking you all to rise, and I'll ask God to dismiss us in prayer, and then we can be dismissed. Almighty eternal God, our Father in heaven, thank you for the privilege of being here with this group, with these people. Thank you for bringing them here. Thank you for the wonderful facility you provided us and for those who have shared and sacrificed to make it possible. Thank you for your protection to bring us all here together safely. Thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, our Commander-in-Chief, there at your right hand, who has commissioned us in the same way that the military has commissioned a great vessel for the purpose of war. So you have commissioned us as vessels for peace and for proclaiming a wonderful message of peace and happiness and productivity and success and harmony and love and forgiveness in the future for all of mankind. We ask that you would bless this work, bless the television program, bless the writing and distribution of the literature, bless all of the hosts and the ministers and their wives and the people who have dedicated themselves to your work and to your church. Bless all those who come and partake. And we ask that you would just continue to cause this church and this group to grow, to be imbued with more and more of your Holy Spirit, with the zeal, the enthusiasm, the awareness of the times in which we live, the awareness of the shortness of time that we have left in which to do the job. Help us to rededicate ourselves to that commission, to see it, to see that clear vision of what the world is going to be like and can be like and will be like. And not too many years hence, there won't be any more repressive regimes like that in Iraq, no more assassination of American soldiers, no more serial killers, no more perverts, no more killers of children, no more killers at our own families, but peace and love and happiness and joy. And we commit our lives into your hands and ask you to put your angels about us to go with us and dismiss us and take us safely back to our homes, and thank you and praise your name. In Jesus Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you all for coming again.